today we shall be discussing about the questions which has been or which were asked in the NEET pattern of 2019 examination for PG entrance examinations. The questions are going to be modified, making it more difficult. Rather, the questions were relatively easier. So starting with the first or beginning with the first question is, now if you read the question, the 75-year-old female, first of all the age is given and the age is elderly female with increasing low backache. Now for having a low backache, there are possibilities that one should have gone through a trauma. There could be a history of heavy weight lifting, but in this case there is no such history which has been mentioned. For the last 5 months, that means it is not an acute event. For the last 5 months is a long duration of the course. So keeping all these things in mind, this is the kind of the condition which we can think in the direction of being a metabolic disorder. Now X-ray is as follows. Now in the X-ray, what do you see? These are the vertebral bodies, and here the difference is that these vertebral bodies are wedged, they are collapsed in comparison to the vertebral bodies above and below. Now which of the following is not true for the condition? First of all, we have to decide that what is the name of the condition. You see, 75-year-old female having a low backache for a long duration precisely is directing towards osteoporosis, that is senile osteoporosis. And we know that in senile osteoporosis, without any trauma or because of trivial trauma, multiple vertebral body wedge collapses are there in the vertebral bodies. The first option that has been mentioned is codfish vertebrae. We all know this codfish vertebrae or fish tail vertebrae or fish mouth vertebrae as well as hourglass vertebrae. These are the different names which are given to the same condition, that is osteoporosis. But you know, through the series of events as far as the publications are concerned, that which of the following should be given precisely a name for representing the conditions of the vertebral body in osteoporosis, they have concluded that codfish and fish mouth vertebrae are the better terms to be used in case of osteoporosis. Why is it so? Because if you look at the codfish from the side profile, it looks like this, and the mouth of the fish, it opens like this. So if we look at the vertebral bodies, these are biconcave because of the collapse. These are the vertebral bodies which gets collapsed, and this is the intervertebral disc in between which resembles the open mouth of the fish or the codfish vertebrae. So the first option was absolutely correct for osteoporosis. Now the next one, Singh index is diagnostic modality of the choice. You know, majority of you might not be aware of the fact that what exactly is Singh index. Every one of us, we have heard about DEXA, that is dual energy X-ray absorptiometry. And we know this, that it is responsible for quantification of osteoporosis and osteopenia. Osteopenia is a condition which is intermediate in between the normal bones and osteoporosis. So DEXA is the investigation of choice nowadays. But what is Singh index? Before this DEXA came into existence, the osteoporosis was quantified by Singh index. And Singh index, so what are the things which were used in this? It was based upon the X-rays of proximal femur and its trabecular pattern. So yes, this is true, that Singh index was used to some extent in the quantification of osteoporosis. But right now, Singh index is not the investigation or the diagnostic modality of choice as far as osteoporosis is concerned. It is replaced by dual energy X-ray absorptiometry. Now the third choice, Z score is for secondary disease. Yes, it is true again. T score is for the quantification of the osteoporosis. That T score is the comparison. It is the comparison of bone mass index of the individual with normal, and the normal one is 30 years old. That means you are comparing the bone mass index or bone mass density with that of a 30-year-old individual. and the T scores are being quantified as that if T score is less than or equal to minus 1, it is considered to be normal. If T score lies in between minus 1 to minus 2.5, then it is considered to be osteopenia. But if T score is less than minus 2.5, then it is considered to be osteoporosis. So it is the WHO definition of osteoporosis. Now, as far as T score is concerned, we cannot compare the two types of osteoporotic patients along with the T score only. So for the quantification or for the recognition of that whether the osteoporosis is because of senile osteoporosis, that is primary, or is it because of secondary osteoporosis, we are having a Z score. And what is Z score? It is the comparison of the bone mass density between the individuals of same age, gender, ethnicity and race. That means you are comparing the bone mass index of almost two identical individuals, on the basis of which if there is a discrepancy in between the scores, one is suffering from secondary osteoporosis. So that condition, that means the third option holds true. Lumbar spine is the most common site to be affected in the vertebral column. This is holds true also because of the reason that the cervical spine, it is responsible for bearing the weight of the head only. Then the thoracic spine, the upper thoracic is responsible for bearing the weight of the upper thorax, but it goes on increasing when we move to the lower thorax. And the moment we have entered onto the lumbar spine, then majority of our body weight is being carried away by the lumbar spine. So if there is a decrease in the density of the bone, then particularly to be compressed are the lumbar vertebrae. So if you look at the four options, Singh index is no more a diagnostic modality of choice. Yes, it was used for the diagnosis before the advent of the DEXA scan. Again, a kind of the question which we were expecting to be asked in nearest of the future, and it did in 2019. We were teaching this with the emphasis on that which part of the scaphoid particularly is more prone to go into non-union, and this is precisely it was asked in 2019 examination. Okay, reading with the question or coming with the question, that which of the following is not correct regarding the fracture shown in the x-ray. So first of all, we have to identify what is the name of the bone which got fractured. You know, these are the carpal bones, and on the lateral most, the uppermost carpal bone is the scaphoid, and it is clearly evident that scaphoid got fractured. So they are asking about anything which is in relation to the scaphoid fracture. So first option is hyperextension and radial deviation of the wrist is the mechanism of injury. Yes, this is true. You see, fall on outstretched hand is the mechanism for trauma in any bone of the upper limb. Like, for example, if a conscious individual is about to fall, then he has to fall on the outstretched hand. No conscious individual can fall in bent hand like this. So hyperextension with the radial deviation of the wrist is responsible for producing tension at the site of the scaphoid. So this holds true for the scaphoid fracture mechanism of injury, that is hyperextension of the wrist as well as radial deviation. So fall on outstretched hand, that is hyperextension, and radial deviation, that is true. So this is the mechanism of injury for the scaphoid fractures. Next, snuff box tenderness. Now the importance of this clinical feature is that majority of the time scaphoid fracture is often missed. Now this is something which is again expected to be asked in nearest of the future. Do remember this fact that scaphoid fractures are very frequently missed in initial diagnosis. So what is the hint that will make you suspicious that probably the scaphoid bone is fractured? The hint is that if there is a tenderness, the tenderness in snuff box. Do remember these words, that even if the initial x-rays are normal but the patient is having a snuff box tenderness, the patient is likely to have sustained a scaphoid fracture, even if the x-rays, initial x-rays are normal. So this second option has got a clinical significance. It is important to remember that snuff box tenderness usually points towards the scaphoid fractures, even if the patient is having no x-ray abnormalities in the initial x-rays, or the clinician is not able to find any bone which is broken in the carpal row. One more thing, that is, among all 8 carpal bones, scaphoid is the most common carpal bone to be broken. After that, it is lunate. Next option, the third one. Distal 1/3 fractures have highest chances to move into non-union. Now, in order to understand this line, because this is something which we were precisely talking about for the last 2.5 years with the hope that it is going to be asked one day, we need to understand what is the anatomical orientation of the blood vessels as far as the scaphoid is concerned. Do consider that if it is the proximal pole of the scaphoid and this is the distal pole of the scaphoid. You know, the vascularity of the scaphoid is precarious, and in the entire bony regions of our body, there are 3 sites where the vascularity is precarious. This is a well-known fact that in the fracture neck of femur, means neck of femur, then the body of the talus, that means the neck of, body of the talus as well as the scaphoid, these are the 3 sites where the vascularity is precarious. And how is it precarious? The reason is, means just by a rough diagrammatic representation, if I try to explain that the vascularity to the distal part of the scaphoid is highest, it is relatively intermediate in the middle part of the scaphoid, and it diminishes to almost nil vascularity as we move proximally. That means the distal part of the scaphoid is most vascular compared to the proximal part of the scaphoid. Now imagine, if this is the scaphoid bone, this is the proximal part, this is the distal part, imagine if there is a fracture in the proximal part and there is a fracture in the distal part. If this fracture line is fracture line A, this fracture line is fracture line B. Because of better vascularity, the chances of union are better in fracture A, while because of poorer vascularity, the chances of union are extremely poor in B. So which one is more prone to go into non-union? Is it fracture A or B? Answer is B, because it is more, because it is having less vascularity. So more proximal the fracture, greater the chances of non-union. This is the gist line, or this is the gist of the scaphoid fracture non-union, that more proximal the fractures, more proximal the fractures, poorer the prognosis. Now, as far as prognosis is concerned, it holds for both non-union as well as avascular necrosis, that means osteonecrosis. You just try to understand that if there is the fracture in the proximal part, then it is the proximal pole which will go into avascular necrosis. So if we come back to the options, or if we read back the option that distal 1/3 fractures have highest chances to move into non-union, no, it is not true, because the distal 1/3 fractures are having better chances of union compared to the proximal fractures. Now, distal fragment is displaced dorsally. Yes, this is also known by the name of DISI deformity in case of a scaphoid fracture. That is, scaphoid fractures, if they are displaced, then the proximal pole goes ventral, while the distal fragment, it moves dorsal. This is the kind of the deformity which happens in all displaced scaphoid fractures. So hope you understand the question, and hope you understand the importance of the precarious vascularity of the scaphoid and its clinical outcome. Thank you very much for listening. Hope you get to know the concepts related to the questions which were asked. It is mandatory to be told that nowadays the questions are not like that you can mug up the one-liners and answer them accordingly. The question pattern has been changing. It has been evolving in the form of being more practical, more explorative, as well as the kind of the concepts which are required for understanding and marking the answers for that particular ask. For rest of the questions, please refer to my next video. Thank you so much, and all the best.